the big 40, but you only look 20. Always giving it your best, even if you don't get any rest. Mama, you're the best in town, there's nobody else around. You're always giving up your time to make us shine. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Oh, I wouldn't be where I am today if it weren't for you. Happy birthday. Oh, I wouldn't be where I am today if it weren't for you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Lord, I pray that you'd give my mommy a happy birthday. Ooh.
Ooh! Yeah, you got to blow out 40 candles. It's like a forest fire or something, I heard. Yeah.
There ain't enough wind for them candles.
Yeah. You got to make a wish now. All right. Now, I have one last surprise, and then after this, we're going to turn it over to We Are Vessel, and I'm really excited about it. If you are sitting more than like two rows back, you may want to turn to the screen in the back. Start that movie for me, if you would, please. Bon Jovi was her first crush, for those of you who don't know. Check out Vera. Look just like Raina. This is a journey of her life. Oh, you look so sweet, babe. Looking cute, babe. just a few more to go, babe. All right, now y'all be careful now. These next pictures may shock you. The good one's coming. Whoa! Almost done, don't worry. The journey of my bride and her life. And one last one just for you, babe. Thor wishes you a happy birthday. Y'all give it up for my wife for her birthday. And at this time, I want to welcome We Are Vessel Band. They're going to take over and lead this service. If it's too loud for you, you can watch in the youth room. There is a nice quiet place that's a little less than volume in the youth room. But we're here to make some noise for Jesus. Amen. We Are Vessel Band. One more time, a round of applause.
How are we feeling today? I just got to say, brother, you have a great wife, because some of those things, if I did, I may not be sleeping in my bed. No, I have a good wife, too. I'm sorry. We didn't have this problem yesterday. We just want to thank real quick. Thank everybody for allowing us to come on such a special day, because I know it's not necessarily the normal day that you would have. We got to celebrate the birthday of the First Lady and also another gentleman here as well. And we got to already see some great musicians. My brother right here. How about Matthew? Did he do great? Him and his brother, both of them. Good songwriting, man. I tell you, we've been blown away ever since we got here. But anyways, we're here. We want to be able to lead you in worship this morning. And then after we do worship, and my brother Noah is going to bring a word with you this morning, we're going to do a rock concert. Is that okay? That's good. Everybody knows what rock concerts involve, right? Okay, good, because it's going to be loud. So I just want to make sure everybody's good to go with that. Y'all give us a second to get set up. Sorry. You would think a band that travels would have been ready to go whenever they said, we're a vessel here. Come on up. Is anybody like awkward times in shows? Because this is awkward, right? I learned a new joke. It's better than my old joke, trust me. I don't know if I can share that joke from a stage in a church, though.
It's fine.
It's fine. Cool. He said I can say it. That's what he said. I'm probably going to get it wrong. They'll have to correct me. All right. Have anybody seen the movie Constipation? Yeah, it hasn't come out yet, so. It's not my joke. I got the pastor's kids. That was that's all them. Good stuff. They had two jokes about poo. That was one of them. Sorry, I don't know why this guitar is so out of whack. I apologize, guys. And then the cable gets pulled out.
You might have to tell that second joke.
All right, Dalton, you want to tell the second joke? Can you do it?
Nah, bro. Tell the joke about the elephants.
You can tell it. I'm sorry, y'all. Give me just a second. I'm going to switch off of this thing to a cable.
All right, guys. So Randall told a joke a couple weeks ago at a concert, and I thought it was pretty funny. So three elephants jump off a cliff. Two hit a road. One hit water. And my brother Noah here is going to have to tell you what sound that makes.
So we're musicians, not comedians. It doesn't look like we're either one at the moment.
Guitar's older than I am.
I may have to borrow a guitar.
We have a couple.
So while I'm kind of trying to repair this real quick, I want to share something. It just keeps coming up in my mind. We love what we do. We love getting to go out and play and minister and do all these things. But I'm going to tell you something. Anybody that's in ministry will be able to tell you as well. Man, sometimes you just fight really hard to be able to do what you do.
Amen.
And adversity comes up all the time. And things like this right here happen more than we want, you know. And it's something so simple, but yet we still have issues. I was laying last night in the bed thinking about something else. And I thought, you know what, because we originally travel as a four-piece band. And we had one of our guys decided that he's gonna go back to school and all, which is great. But he kind of left us high and dry on this one in a short amount of time. And the pastor shared something yesterday, Brother Glenn, about, you know, things happening that have to happen in order for change to happen. And I was thinking about the fires that were coming through our area back several years ago. And, you know, the fire came through and it was bad. It tore everything down, destroyed it all. Can I borrow your guitar, Matthew?
Christian.
Get Christian, your guitar. I'm sorry. They told me Matthew.
Yeah.
I was back. The fire came through and wiped everything out. Had to start completely over. Fire came through. After the fire was gone and some time was allowed, everything grows back greener, stronger. Way better than it ever was to begin with.
Amen.
So as for us, when we go through things, we have trials, tribulation, things like that, where things just seem like they want to tear us down, break us apart. We seem like it's that, you know, things are just fighting us, like we had just not having our whole band and having to really work at trying to get things together. I'm just remembered, I thought about that tonight, last night. You know, we're going to go through this fire. That's fine. We're going to have things that it's going to look bad for a little while. It's going to be smutty and dark and gray. But sometimes the fire's got to come through just to get things changed. God's got to shake things up.
That's right.
For things to get greener and better on the other side. So, guys, I don't know if that's for anybody else. When we travel, I tend to get ministered to more than I minister to somebody else, I promise you. So I was really discouraged and down. And this really, last night, this God just really comforted me in knowing what I'm called to do and what we're going to do. And we're just going to push through and we're going to do this thing, because everything happens the way God wants it to happen. It's not about our time. It's not about how it wants to go. I might keep this guitar. I'm just kidding. That being said, is everybody ready to worship a little bit in there? All right, so let's stand up. Let's forget about all this awkwardness and all this other jazz.
Hey,
and let's
Randall.
Yes, sir.
You're not coming through the feed on that guitar. Got you now.
I am. Okay, cool.
Thank you.
Thank you. I will always remember this place. This is the place where I was going to extremely awkward for a long period of time. All right, guys. Let's worship the Lord. Let's do this, Noah. Come on. Let's get loud. Come on.
Is alive. Empty cross, empty grave. Life eternal, you have won today. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Jesus, you are mine.
In this joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, wash my sin away. Yeah.
worship you. We give you all the praise for who you are, God. And I thank you for that happy day, God, that I was able to come and be saved and all my sins washed away. This next song, guys, I would love if you would sing along with us a little bit. I think a lot of you know it. I've seen a lot of guys sing on this last one. So I think we're going to be able to just bring down the heavens in this place tonight. Is that going to be, or this morning, I'm sorry, I'm used to doing the night. So I hope you, and let's just worship and sing with us today. As we know, His love never fails and never ends. And higher than the mountains that I face, You're stronger than the power of the grave. You're constant in the trials and the change. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Stronger than the power of the grave. You're constant in the trials and the change. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Let me hear you sing it. Your love never fails, never gives up. Let me hear you say, true love. Oh, you sound good. Sing it loud. Oh, God, it's your love. It's your love.
with the Lord.
My debt is paid. There's nothing that can separate my heart.
Let's give a crazy praise in this place today.
Shared a little bit already. I'll be really brief, but I believe there's somebody here that needs to hear this. About 9 years ago now, I felt the passion and the calling to play guitar and later to become a worship leader. And so I began to get my guitar out. My wife bought me a guitar. I began to play and learn. I began to try to sing. Yes, I tried to sing. And I became very, very involved in my church worship team. We was already youth pastors at the church we were at. And I just remember one day our music minister came or didn't make it to the revival we were in. And I got my guitar and I said, it's okay. We'll get through this. God's called me to this. I know I feel like I can push through and we can worship God tonight together. And so I get on stage, I get my guitar out. I don't remember the worship set, but we sing. It was me, a drummer, and I think maybe a bass player. And I just did it for my acoustic guitar. We sing, we went through, and we got done. Next night we come up. Same thing, music minister's out. It was a family emergency. I said, okay, thank you God for giving me this opportunity. This is what I've wanted to try to get to where I could do. And granted, I will say I wasn't very good. I have a hard time saying I'm very good now. You know, I just know God carries me places. But I remember I got up to sing, and the microphone was not on. So I looked at the sound guy. Like, you know, anytime there's a problem on stage, musicians know this. The first thing you do is blame the sound guy, okay? As a sound guy, too, just please don't do that. That's terrible. But that's what I did. I looked at the sound guy. I'm like, hey, man, what's going on? You know, that's the international sign for either I don't sound good or something's wrong, you know? And he says, he just kind of shrugged his shoulders. I'm like, okay, well, there's a bad cable. You know, he's got everything on back there. That's great. So I push through. We sing a worship set. I do it anyways. You can't hear the vocals. It's okay. We still worship. So we get done. I go back to the sound booth, and I say, hey, man, is it a bad cable? Do I need to try to change it before altar call? And he's like, no. He said, the pastor said not to turn your microphone on. You know, you can be bad, and you can be me bad, you know? For the pastor to turn your microphone off, you know? But look, let me tell you what that did to me. I used to struggle with depression really bad. Wrecked my life right there and everything that I thought I was supposed to be doing. First thing I thought, I just backed out of the sound booth, walked out the door, said, I'm done. I'm not playing guitar. I'm not singing. It's not for me. I'm going to go back to racing cars. so I left. I went down the road. I called a friend of mine. I was in a band at the time. I called him up. He was our singer. I said, "Hey, man, I just want to let you know I'm done with the band. You know, don't plan on me coming back to practice." He's like, "What's going on?" So I explained the whole situation to him, and I said, "I'm done." And he said, "Let me tell you something, man." He said, "I've seen your heart." He said, "Don't let man decide what your passion is or what your calling that God has on your life is. He doesn't know. Man doesn't know." He said, "Look, if you're called to that and you're passionate about it, it may not be your timing. It may not be God's timing. But look, it's what it's going to be. You just got to push through." Over the last little bit, man, I turned around. I went back to that church. It was just in time for altar call. And you got to think, I was on staff at this church too. I went back. It's just in time for altar call. Grabbed my guitar, went to sing altar. Microphone still off. But I gave it everything that I had that night. And I declared to God, I said, "God, I may not be good, but I'm going to be faithful." And he showed me over the last year. And he's like, "Look, I don't need you to be good. I just need you to be faithful. Look what I can do." Over this past year, we've toured all over this country. I've opened up for bands like Building 429. Whoever you could think of, we've almost seen 10th Avenue North, Colton Dixon. It's been an incredible ride even this year. But let me tell you something real quick. It's not about those shows that I get to do. He has showed me that he just needs me to be faithful because he carries me to these places. He Amen. Carries us to these places to meet the brokenhearted, to meet those that are in need, that need stories like this, that need to hear where we come from. He doesn't need me to be good.
Amen.
He doesn't need you to be good either. He just needs you to be faithful.
Thank you, Jesus.
Real quick, I want to sing something right here. Because I believe that it's in the power in the name of Jesus that I'm able to overcome and to just give it all to Him. And today, right now, before Noah comes up, I want you to do the same thing. If you know there's a calling that you have on your life, there's something that you know that man is telling you, "I'm not good enough to do," or even your mind or the enemy is telling you, "I'm not good enough to do," but you know for a fact what you're supposed to do. This is for you. Declare it right here tonight, today, this morning.
Amen.
That there is power in the name of Jesus to carry you and do for you. Because there is power in the name of Jesus. Because there is power in the name of Jesus. Because there is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. To break all your chains in here. Chains of depression that keep you from doing what you're doing. Chains of bondage. Chains of addiction. They can be loosed and gone today. One more time. Sing this with me as Noah begins to come up. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. Well, there is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. One more time, sing, break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
Amen, amen, amen. You may be seated as Noah comes. We're going to let the kids be released at this time to go to kids' class. Listen, kids, when the band comes back up to get ready for the rock set, we want you to come back and join us, okay? We don't want you to miss the concert. But kids, you can be released at this time as Noah gets ready to bring forth this word. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, Noah, while we're waiting on the parents just to come back in, can we get Randall just to lead us in that course just a little bit more? And let's just stand and just sing that together as we're waiting on our parents to join us.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus.
Come on, everybody sing.
'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. 'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. This is an army rising up. This is an army rising up. This is an army rising up. Here the promised land. Oh, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. This is an army rising up.
Thank you, Lord.
This is an army rising up. Well, there's an army rising up. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain.
Y'all give the Lord a hand. Give a clap offering to Jesus. Noah, I'm going to turn it over to you at this time. You need a mic? Okay.
Good morning. Before we get going, I just want to open up in prayer. Just spend a moment with God. His Spirit's here right now. I feel it. His Spirit is here right now with us. The very glory of God is in this place. Hallelujah. Father, we come to you today, God. And we thank you, Lord. God, I'm so humbled by this place, God, the gratitude and the love and the familyship that's already been shown. God, I thank you, Father. I pray that you would hide me behind the cross this moment for these next few minutes as I bring, God, what you put on my heart. Father, God, I praise you, God. I praise you, God. Thank you for your Spirit. Stay thick in this atmosphere, God. Holy Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. This past week has been rough. Like Randall was sharing earlier, we're normally a four-piece, and our other guitar player couldn't make it. He had something come up that he couldn't miss out on. Every day that it got closer to here, it seems like I got sicker every single day as I was getting closer. We had equipment issues this morning. The computer that's running our tracks, it's acting crazy back there right now. The enemy is fighting something that's going to take place this morning. And I'm going ahead, I'm standing firm on the word of God and saying, enemy, you have no place here. You have no place in this house. This is God's house. We rebuke you and we cast you out in the name of Jesus. We are covered by the blood of Christ for what he did on Calvary. This is your house. I wrestled all week long with what the message should be. I thought it was this, and then I thought it was something else. And I prayed, and I thought I was being led this way. And last night, we tend, when you're preparing for something, you tend to, a lot of times, overthink it. I started overthinking it last night. And I was wrapped up in myself, but because of what I thought I should speak about this morning. And I got on the phone with my brother, and he and I prayed last night, and we spoke to each other, and God did exactly what I was hoping he would do. He completely changed it. He completely changed it. So that always be submissive to the Holy Spirit and what he tells you to do. So this morning, I'm going to do something I've done before because I feel very strong about it. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my life and some things I've been through and what God's done. That's one thing you can always use against the enemy is your testimony. Your testimony shows the power of God in your life. The power of God in your life. And the enemy can't do anything about it. He can't do anything. And this isn't a sad time. Let's see some smiling faces. We're in the joy of the Lord. We're in the joy of the Lord. I used to think back on my life, and I'd get kind of depressed even thinking about it. So I was like, man, I was so far gone. Back in 2008, I was raised in a Christian home. I was raised in a Christian home and, you know, taught to do the right things and was told to be good. And so, you know, that's what I did. And I learned a lot of things that I still use now. But I got kind of tired of being complacent. I didn't take the Christian walk seriously. You know, I thought I could live, you know, a pretty good life. You know, I don't do wrong or anybody. I can go out and as long as I'm not hurting anybody, I can party on the weekends. You know, I can drink. I can do this. I can do that. And when I was 18, I was drumming for my old church every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night for 3 years. Every single service. And I got burned out. And the enemy started wrapping me up in lies and deceit. And so I was like, you know, I don't have to go to church every Sunday. I don't have to live, you know, the best life. As long as I don't majorly hurt anybody, I think I'm okay. So I stepped away from the church. And in 2009, I went to the hospital for a surgery. And after the surgery, it was a pretty major deal. I think I was in surgery for 4 or 5 hours, I think. And they were removing my gallbladder. And when they got out, it was something I'd been ignoring for a while, because I don't know if I'm like any of you guys. I don't want to go to the hospital. I was like, I can fight it. I'll be fine. It finally got so bad, it was starting to gangrene inside of me. I would have gotten seriously sick had I not went. But I went, I had the surgery, I was in the hospital for about 7 days. And when I got out, you know, they're like, the doctors, you know, when you go through something like that, you can tell them, you know, I'm really hurting. And they'll pretty much load you up with any pain medicine. I went through a time for about eight months or so. It wasn't that long, but it was enough. I was in church. I wasn't praying. I wasn't reading my Bible. I more or less put God on the back burner and thought I didn't need him in my life. And I got addicted to pain medications. And I was mixing that with alcohol. And as soon as my prescriptions ran out, there's a girl I was working with that that could get whatever prescriptions that I wanted, more or less. She was like, I've got that stuff. I can get it. And I started buying it from her. And come to find out, she was getting them illegally too, and she actually went to jail for a while. And I could have gotten easily wrapped up. There was tons of emails and text messages. Hey, where are you at? Where can I meet you? Where can I get this stuff? And through that, I went through, I hate to use this, but I hope you are okay. I went through a lot of hell on this earth. Through depression, I was living in an old house in Hoboken, Georgia. There's holes in the floor. You can see the dirt under the house. The water pump didn't work to the house. I'd have to get up real early with a couple of milk jugs and go to my neighbor's house and steal some water out of their faucet so I could take a shower. There was hardly ever food at my house, but there was always alcohol. Always alcohol. And I went through this for about 8 months. My friends, they abandoned me. I was too far gone. I didn't talk to my family anymore, and I'm extremely close to my mother, and for me to only talk to her one time a week, there's something wrong. There's something dead wrong. And I didn't talk to my dad for probably 2 months. None of my family knew what I was going through. I tried to keep it all a secret, like I had it together. Let me tell you something, the minute you think you have it together, you need to reevaluate things. The minute you believe I'm on the straight and narrow, and I have all my ducks in a row, you better start praying. But I was still living in that house, and there was a shed out back, and this is how bad it was. There's a homeless guy in the area that he had broken into the house before, and he actually would stay in the shed by my house. So I come home and I have to put my headlights on my vehicle on the window, and I'd see his head pop up. I'm like, you gotta leave, man. I mean, I was in a bad situation where it wasn't too hard to get to me if you needed to. But I fought depression, suicide thoughts. Many nights I laid on the couch crying, because I had pretty much forgotten about God. I was like, how am I going to get myself out of this situation? I laid there with my shotgun on my lap. I was like, God, you're never going to use me. I don't even know if you're real. Why should I go on? I know a lot of people have had that thought. Why should I go? And so there's one night I got exceptionally messed up. And once again, I cried myself to sleep because I hated who I was. I couldn't get myself out of it. I couldn't get myself out of it. I needed my Savior. I needed my Jesus. I needed him. I still need him. I need him every minute. I need him right now. This Christian walk, it's not a game. It is not a game. This is an everyday pursuit of the love that was bore for us on the cross of Calvary. Jesus is so real. That night, I laid down. And cried myself to sleep, depressed, suicidal thoughts, hungry, tired. I got to the point I couldn't function in the morning without getting drunk and getting out of bed. I couldn't walk hardly without something in my body to make me not sober. So I laid there on the futon. There's a window unit in the living room, thank God, or I would have eaten it to death. But I laid there on the futon in the living room, cried myself to sleep. The next morning, with a loud, thundering voice, in my mind, the entire world heard it. God said, Noah, you're done with this. I have work for you to do. God spoke to me. I dropped every addiction that day. Cold turkey. It was done. So this is where it ties together. And I thank God. And thank you, Jesus. Verse 11 through 24. Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one, I'm the youngest in my family. And my father only has two sons. From his biological sons, I'm the youngest. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to be a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I was close to death. I was close to it. I could feel it. It was just a matter of probably hours for me, days for me. Verse 18 says, I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found. So they begin to celebrate. When God woke me up, and it took an act of God. An act of God. I couldn't do it myself. We can't do it ourselves. We have to give everything we have to Jesus Christ. If we don't give all we have to him and surrender completely, that was for nothing. That was for nothing. If it was only me, if it was only Vera, if it was only Pastor, if it was only Matthew, if it was only you, he still would have done it. He still would have done it because he loves you so much.
Yes.
But you gotta give it to him. I wasn't ready to give it to him because I thought I could get myself out. We need Jesus. This country needs Jesus. You see what's going on in Paris. You see what's going on in Lebanon, in Kenya. What's happening here in the United States.
Right.
We need Jesus. We should be on fire, a light on a hill. We are his children. Yes. We are the disciples of Christ. We should be going out and making other disciples and leading them to him. What is our great commission? Lead people to him. Christ loved us so much. Full of mercy, full of grace and love, because we're going to fail. I fail him every single day.
That's right.
If anything, I'm preaching to myself.
Yes.
I am preaching to myself because we fail every single day. There's a song called How He Loves. And part of the word said, if grace is an ocean, then we're all sinking. God's grace is imminent. It's all around us.
Yes.
I want to be sinking in your grace every day, God.
Yes.
Fill me up with your love and your passion and your mercy. Set me on a hill so that I can shine for you. God, I am here for you. Send me. God, if not for you, I would not be alive. I would be dead in the grave, God. Thank you, Father. God, I pray that your spirit surrounds each and every person here, God, that it sets ablaze in them, God, that they can go out and bring people to you, God.
Yes.
You're so good. I can't keep this to myself. It's not meant to stay just with us. It's meant to share it with the world, that every person would hear the name of Jesus Christ and know the truth that is the Word of God.
Yes.
Genesis 1:1, the Word was with God and God is the Word. It's the truth.
Yes.
The power of Christ is in all of us through the Holy Spirit. We're covered under the blood. The blood that was shed on Calvary, the blood that runs through our veins as a royal priesthood of the God on high.
Yes.
As I went, as God woke me up that day, I was amazed. I was amazed. I saw new color, it seemed like, new smells. Everything was back to life again.
Yes.
I called my mom. I wasn't quite ready to tell him all that I'd been through. God's healed me of that. I'll share it with anybody. It doesn't matter to me. I've got power over the devil.
Amen.
With the word of my testimony.
Amen.
So do all of you. But my mom, God, I love her. I love my mom. She said, you can come home. As I asked, I said, can I come home? I need help. She said, yeah, you can come home. You have to talk to your father first. And I was like, hold on, wait a second. Wait a second, mom, you're supposed to love me. You're supposed to let me in, just let me in. She's like, he's the head of this household. You have to talk to him first.
Amen.
She handed the phone to him and I'm like, dad? He's like, yeah. And keep in mind, I may have said two words to him in 2 months. I said, Dad, I need to come home. I need to come home.
Amen.
I've gotten caught up in some real bad stuff, but God has set me free. I need to come home. And he said, the greatest thing in our relationship growing up was never, he was always there. He worked a lot. He was always there. If I went to him and I needed something, I could. But as far as a loving relationship, we didn't really have it. Not that neither one of us wanted to. He just didn't know how to show true love to his children because his father didn't know how. See, that's when the love of Christ comes in, because God can show you that stuff.
Amen.
But but he said the greatest thing. He said, when will you be home? He didn't even say yes. He just said, when will you be home? And in 2 days, I was back home.
Thank you, Jesus.
I was back home. My father opened his house back to me, just like the prodigal son, after I'd went off and squandered everything I had. I barely had some clothes. My car was barely running. But he let me home.
Amen.
God's calling to you.
That's right.
God's calling to you today.
That's right.
Come home, my son. Come home, my daughter, my child. Come home. Be washed in the blood. I'm almost done. I know I've spoke a long time, but I'm almost done. The coolest thing, God is so cool, isn't he?
Amen.
God is so awesome. He lets you do stuff he never lets you do. After I went through that, I never thought I would have toured the country. And I know God's, we're on to bigger and greater things, even past this, or past the stage now. But God's cool. He has a way of showing up and doing something exponential in your life. He just has that way. It's kind of like a master plan. He's kind of got, he is the master. Before you're born, he has the blueprints to your life.
That's right.
Before this building was made, he had the blueprints to this building. God, man, he has a plan. Couple years earlier, this it was in 2014, I think. A friend of mine that owned that house I was staying in Hoboken, Georgia. He owned the house and he owned the land, and he wanted to build a new house. And we're all still good friends. He called me and said, "Hey, man, what you doing this weekend?" I said, "I don't think I have anything planned." He said, "Why don't you come out to the old house?" I said, "Okay." Me and all my friends that had abandoned me at that time, we all met there, and we tore that house down together.
Hallelujah.
We tore the house down together. I've never felt so freed and healed in my life than when I put a sledgehammer through the front door.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
God can tear down your past.
That's right.
You just got to give it to him.
That's right.
You got to give it to him. He's so cool, isn't he? He's so good. He's so good. Hallelujah. I'm going to pray for some people today. Can I do that?
Amen. Yeah. We're going to open up the altar, don't we?
Yeah. We want to open up the whole altar. Just thank you, God. Father, we come to you, God. We praise you, God. We thank you for today because you're so good. You're so powerful, God, that you let me be in a house full of depression and despair and then delivered me from it.
Yes.
And took me back to tear it down. Thank you, God. Because you're so good. God, today we want to tear down some of our past.
Yes.
God, we want to tear those houses, God, those strongholds that have been holding in our minds and our hearts. God, we want to let those go today. We want to let those go today, God, in your blood and through you, God. So I invite anybody that wants to get past this to come up here. I want to pray with you. Pastor wants to pray with you.
Let's all stand. And if you need your past tore down today, I'm going to ask my brother Noah just to join me down here. We want to pray for you. And listen, I know you came for a concert. The concert's still coming. Chill. It'll be all right. We're praying that you get a chance to meet Jesus first. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Come at this time.
You're still in now. With you, be still and know that I am here.
be still and know that I'm with you. Be still and know. When the darkness comes upon you and covers you with fear and shame, be still and know that I'm with you. Will say your name.
If you need to come, come, come now.
And sleep no longer comes. Just remember all the words I said. Be still and know. And when you go through the valley and shadows come out from the hill, if morning never comes to be still and know. And if you forget which way to go and lose where you come from, if no one standing beside you, be still and know I am. When darkness comes upon you and covers you, be still and know that I'm with you. Be still and know I am. If terror falls upon your bed and sleep no longer comes, just remember all the words I said. Be still and know. And when you go through the valley, and shadows come from you, if morning never comes to be, go and lose where you come from, if no one is standing beside you, be still and know I am. Be still and know that I no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. Here in your love, set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Fire in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God.
You know, I've had a really wonderful time today. Noah, I appreciate that word and that testimony. The devil won't leave us alone today, will he? Listen, we're bringing the kids back over here. Everybody just be seated just for a second. The kids are on their way back over. They're all coming back over as a group. We are Vessel Band. They have been worshiping with us. They brought the word. They are going to hopefully do the show if the equipment works. But before we do that, listen. I don't know if you know this or not. This equipment's expensive. Gas is not cheap. It takes money to be able to come and do these things. This is their ministry, as well as their part-time / full-time jobs and their livelihood. And we want to take up a love offering just to tell them how much we appreciate them today and to bless them as they get prepared to leave. If you didn't bring any money, you can write a check. If you want to write it to Promised Land, we'll make sure they get it. If you want to write it to We Are Vessel, you can do that. They also have merchandise for sale at the end of the show. You can support them by buying a t-shirt, a CD, or other things like that. But we want to support this group because they have been a blessing to us, and I know that the good Lord Almighty is anointing them. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just ask for your anointing upon this time. Lord, that you would just prepare this offering, Lord God, that we're taking up for them, Lord, that it would be a blessing to them. In Jesus' name, amen. And I won't kill the lights till they get done.
You want to hear another joke?
Sure.
That's all I got. I only had two. I had one when I came here, and I got two now. Make sure that works. Sorry.
Hey, that one works. And also, as a blessing to everyone that's here today, we will have DVDs and CDs of the service available for you at the close of the service. Ready?